Hey, what's up? It's Jim, and today I'm going to talk about Fantastic Beasts and where to find them. The problem with most prequels is there's kind of no stakes to them. They're trying to kind of capture lightning in a bottle again from a previous franchise that was lucky in terms of casting and directors and everything kind of coming together and hoping a whole new franchise can suddenly work. And that's usually the trend with big studio prequels. And Fantastic Beasts is exactly like any big studio prequel that you've seen before. It's disappointing. And although I am a Harry Potter movie fan, and I was excited for this movie, and even though it's directed by David Yates, who did the last four Harry Potter movies, and actually written by J.K. Rowling as her screenwriting debut, this movie just really doesn't work and is very disappointing and boring and not very fun at all, and doesn't really manage to capture any of the lightning in a bottle that the Harry Potter films were lucky enough to have. But you also had really streamlined, great Hollywood screenwriting and a studio that seemed to know what they were doing with Warner Brothers throughout the 2000s. But now you have Warner Brothers in 2016. The acting's not really there in most of this movie for most of the cast members. The screenwriting's not really there, and you can't really get us into the characters. It's not as inviting, it's not as exciting. There's nothing really there to latch onto, and you end up with a really disappointing prequel. And I kind of, while watching it, was wondering, like, what exactly were they trying to do with it? There's no real theme to it. It's not going through a mystery. I did kind of start to think that maybe the problem was that although David Yates made four Harry Potter movies, he wasn't the person who introduced us to Harry Potter. And maybe he's more of a good sequel director than he is making the first film in a franchise. You know, the interesting thing about Harry Potter is, although it was a big studio blockbuster, it felt so different from anything else coming out. It felt unique. It was like, oh, this special tradition of a Harry Potter movie. And so many things are missing from it, but they didn't find a new way to do it that felt original and opening up a new world. It felt very hackneyed and corporately driven. You know, you don't have like this uniquely like English movie. The only one who's English is Eddie Redmayne because it takes place in New York. It doesn't really do much with its 1920s setting, which seems to be a hodgepodge of what people sort of think happened in the 20s. But style-wise, it's kind of like mixes, you know, what happened in the 20s with some 30s style I saw in there, which wasn't going on at this point. You know, there's like a thing called the Depression that hadn't happened yet, but it seems to be that most of the people who made this didn't care, and you kind of get that apathy that kind of runs throughout the whole movie and kind of hoping that you'll sort of be okay with it. It also has way too many characters going on, making it feel like a typical messy big studio movie, and it actually kind of acts like a lot of this will work out in future films rather than make it one individual story that's a part of a larger thing, which the Harry Potter franchise did so well. This is so disappointing on so many levels, and the only kind of solace I have is that I can kind of forget about it because Harry Potter and Hogwarts aren't involved in this, and I can just disregard it because it's a very disregardable film. In 1926, Newt Scamander arrives in New York City carrying a mysterious suitcase full of magical, fantastic creatures and beasts and whatnot, and he's writing his book, Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them. Unfortunately, one of the beasts gets loose. This platypus who steals things, who's kind of my favorite character in the whole movie, he accidentally mixes up his case with a nomadge, as they're apparently called in America, instead of muggle, because America has crappier slang, I guess, in this movie. I don't know. He accidentally switches his case in such a predictable thing, you'd think it's something out of a dumb sitcom, but it happened in this movie. It was so obvious that was gonna happen. You're like, oh wow, they have cases that look the same. I hope they don't take each other's suitcase by mistake. And then he has to go find the guy because he's released some of the Fantastic Beasts, and the American Magic Coalition or whatever is trying to stop these beasts from coming out. And as Newt Scamander also is dealing sort of with this evil thing that's going on as well, and hopefully he can get all his fantastic beasts into his suitcase. This was directed by David Yates, who is kind of now directed more Harry Potter or J.K. Rowling things than anybody. And between this and Legend of Tarzan earlier this year, I have lowered my opinion considerably of David Yates. I think he used to feel like someone who was a lot more interesting than I thought he could be, but now he just feels like studio hired hand for studio mandated sequels and remakes and prequels, and he's kind of just a crappy studio yes man who's pretty good at doing what he does. Legend of Tarzan feels very studio mandated. This feels even worse. They're two movies I don't think anyone was sitting around really wanting necessarily, but he ends up directing them. And for someone who has such a promising career ahead of him after Deathly Hallows Part 2, the fact that he's put out two movies like this in 1 year is as disappointing as he used to be promising. And also, you know, most of this Harry Potter thing was him taking the style that Karan and Newell had introduced. He probably screamed of a really good studio director, and that's always pretty much what he was, but at this point, like, a movie like this, he just feels like a formerly really good studio director that's pretty good at working on special effects. I kind of almost want him to maybe make a different kind of movie, or, well, make a good movie again, since I've had to sit through both of these, as kind of some way to sort of make it up to me. Then the script in this is so bad. Like, it's a really bad script. There's, like, so many characters. John Voight's character, who, like, runs a newspaper and whose son is a senator, is just, like, never really goes anywhere, and it feels a real lack of any sort of theme. Even the weaker Harry Potter things, they'd be saying things about, like, fascism or rules or secrets, or there'd be this mystery running throughout it that really connected with the characters and what was going on in their lives and such, and would actually have stakes to it. And Fantastic Beasts doesn't really have that at all, and has a lot of plot threads that I'm not sure where they're going, and if they are coming back, I sort of don't care because it doesn't really work within this movie. It's almost like relying on the fact that hopefully the sequel will get this movie to work, but this movie never gets itself to work. I'm surprised by that because Steve Kloves, who wrote all the screenplays except for Order of the Phoenix, was a producer on this and apparently helped with the script, but not enough to be credited for. I kind of wish J.K. Rowling and him had both written it, because he always made the Harry Potter movies so good. But in this, it feels like a lot of erroneous details that really needed to be cut out and brought down. How they don't really introduce Newt Scamander. There's not a scene that goes, and this is the scene where we as the audience understand what kind of a person Newt Scamander is. It's just like, hey, he's got this suitcase full of beasts, and we're like, cool, what kind of person is he? And he goes, oh, he has to get the beasts in the suitcase. And you're like, right, yeah, no, I get that, but like, where's the part where I meet him? And he's like, oh, he switched his suitcase. And you're like, again, where's the connection here? Like, in the first Harry Potter, I'm like, oh, he lives under the stairs and has really shitty caregivers and he seems really modest. I kind of feel like I know who Harry Potter is. And in this, all I know about Newt Scamander is he supposedly has fantastic beasts and he needs to find them. That's cool, I guess. He's not very charismatic, so I'm supposed to follow him? He's the guy you put in this movie? Okay, alright, cool. I guess, hey, you know, I guess you know better than me. There's not that connection there. And for movies that are very populous and usually more easier to go down, this movie is acting like maybe it's trying to do something different with a different kind of protagonist. But if it is, it's not like you can really introduce that kind of arty thing to it. It just looks like a failure of populist filmmaking. And it's surprising that probably the best character is like someone who's supposed to be the comedic sidekick, which was Dan Fogler's character. He has an arc in this. He's like the only muggle in the whole thing. He sees everything going on. He wants to be a baker. His whole arc really works. And that was actually surprising, because you don't think the person to have the best arc in the whole movie is to be like the comedic sidekick. But then no one else really had a good story, which is kind of the problem. Nate Scamander doesn't really have an arc except for like he finds the beasts and you're like, cool, that's something I can relate to. then they have whole sequences where you're just watching them do, you know, tons of computerized effects, which is like, why do we still think that's an okay thing to have in a movie anymore? Like, no one's impressed at computerized effects. Like, all right, that seemed cool like 10 years ago, and even then it felt a little boring. Why do you keep doing that? Like, you're focusing on it too much, and this movie's really long, and it slows down for reasons I don't understand. It just has such a really stilted flow to it, and I don't know if that's because J.K. Rowling has enough power that she didn't have to like keep rewriting things. This is almost like they're going in reverse and going back to how Chris Columbus did things, but you know, with a crappy script as well. Fantastic Beasts just feels so kind of artificial. I think if you're a big fan of Harry Potter, you'll sort of be fine with it, but I don't think it really deserves to be on the shelf with the other DVDs or Blu-rays or whatever of the rest of the franchise. It's such a lesser entry. It really is actually probably the Phantom Menace of the Harry Potter cinematic universe, because it's disappointing. Well, okay, I actually shouldn't say that, because the Phantom Menace had that pod race scene in Darth Maul, and this, other than the platypus who steals things, has nothing that's really that cool or memorable about it. I love the platypus who steals things. I love a bunch of the beasts in it, but that's about it. Most of the action is poorly directed, which is really surprising. All other action sequences David Yates made in Harry Potter were outstanding, and you look at Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them, and it just looks like they rushed it. This film screams of apathy and just kind of relying on the fact that an audience is going to show up anyway, which is kind of the thing that was so shocking about the Harry Potter movies, is they kind of knew that, but they actually tried and ended up making pretty decently made movies. Most of the Harry Potter movies, I would say, are actually really, really good and show the good side of studio filmmaking, whereas Fantastic Beasts shows a side of studio filmmaking I'd like to forget about. It's kind of the Harry Potter films we probably thought we were going to end up getting, not the series we actually got. Not having a connection to any of the characters, not having anything that exciting going on, it's just like, why should I see this over Doctor Strange? You just made me kind of think, like, what the fuck? Like, really? Like, this is your... why did you come back with this? And it never gives you an answer. It even doesn't really do a really great job with its actors. You know, Eddie Redmayne has won his Oscar, but he can't really be charismatic in this. I didn't really even like Ezra Miller in this. Colin Farrell is never good in a big studio movie, so that's not like a surprise at all to me. I didn't really like the group. I actually did like Dan Fogler. He like steals the movie. I don't think he expected that, because he really gets the best arc, and I think he knows what to do with it. Alison Chabal I liked as well, but Katherine Waterston maybe wasn't as great as she usually is. This is just kind of a lot of wasted potential working on a big studio thing. It's definitely the worst Harry Potter movie I've ever seen, and I am really disappointed, because I didn't think this was going to be the best one. I didn't have high expectations, but I thought they'd have fun with the time period, which they don't. I thought that Eddie Redmayne, this would be his big kind of like breakout star thing. I mean, it is in terms of this movie will make money. And this movie just like maybe like rang out all of its charisma or something before they used it like a beach towel or something, and just like put it on spin dry as well to like make sure there was no moisture whatsoever or charisma to really take from this, because there just frankly isn't. I know, you know, the book is based on is like a fun little resource book, but you know, Mean Girls was too. Fantastic Beasts is just another disappointing big studio prequel. And that's really all it is. It has all the same problems and trappings that you're used to from that. Bring back this franchise, a franchise that seemed to fly in the face of all of that crap for its entire 10-year existence, to bring it back and make it be the very thing that it was normally the antithesis of in terms of studio filmmaking is as disappointing as it is predictable. I don't know if it's necessarily something you should really even waste your time with unless you're a big Harry Potter fan. This kind of studio filmmaking isn't something I really have much interest in, and I would like them to maybe at least try, and I couldn't even really get much of that from it. This is a very forgettable entry in a very memorable series, and that's insanely disappointing. I really am not excited for this new franchise. I'm not exactly sure what they're going to do with it. I know they're going to go into, like, the guy who's Voldemort before there was a Voldemort, and, like, that could be cool, but it's fucking Johnny Depp, so I'm not really even into that. This just made me disappointed and worried and apprehensive that I'm going to have to sit through a crappy franchise like Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them, and that's something I never thought I would feel from a Harry Potter movie. So congrats to J.K. Rowling and David Yates for taking a big dump on their entire legacy to make a movie like this. So if you have seen Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them, then comment below in the comments and subscribe if you would like to.